Hi guys. Well, I've been a busy little bee. To start with, as some of you may know, I've got an original Xbox, but I'm loath to sink serious amounts of time into it because on more than one occasion through the years I've lost all my save games. Now I did get this, which is a memory card, and some of the save games are on this, but I've been wanting to back up the backup. There has been a cable on eBay, which is more than £20, and I've been watching it for a while, but all of a sudden, up popped this, which is the Exploder Game Saves. Now, Linux doesn't want to see this for some reason. I don't know why. But yeah, it was only just over a tenner. I'm going to have to try it on the Windows 7 machine and see if it will see it. Time will tell, I suppose. Sometimes you just got to take a punt. Talking about taking a punt, I've also been doing something else. I don't know if you're going to be able to see this, but it's one of the clocks. There you go, I think that's, you can possibly see it. It's one of the cheaper clocks that you just assemble yourself. for less than £5. The more expensive clock is still there waiting to be assembled. And how the heck this is running, I don't know. Now, I got a few things wrong, including the thermistor, which doesn't seem to want to work properly because this keeps thinking that it's 50 degrees C. You'll probably see it in a moment as it changes. Is it saying it now? There it goes. It still thinks it's 50 degrees C no matter what I do. So, yeah. And also, I got a few of the heights wrong. So the display isn't fitting flush to the board, so the case doesn't work properly, and that's a right mess. Long story short, this was a complete hatchet job. It beats the living daylights out of me as to how this is functioning at all. Now, one of the other things that Big Clive did say is that on the cheaper versions, instead of the two chips, they're just running the one chip. But this is one of the cheaper versions, and this does actually have the two chips in it, the long one and the short one for timing, as well as the crystal. So, who knows? It just seems to be the same as one of the others, but with a few less components. Quite a few less components, actually. It was a hatchet job, and I think I've worked out a technique for practicing soldering. Yes, the BBC Micro boards are here, and also the stand is here as well. It's okay, I'm liking it. It's going to take some getting used to. More on that in a future video. But desoldering a board like that in order to get practice at soldering isn't very efficient, I don't think. So I've come up with a plan. I have a cunning plan. The cunning plan has cost less than £10 and will arrive in China, from China, I should say, in about 3 or 4 weeks. Possibly thereabouts. I've actually got enough parts to start my cunning plan, and I hope to find the time to do that tomorrow night, which will just be a quick test on a few things to see whether or not my cunning plan will work. I learnt a few more things in doing that. Now, my station, I'll go through a lot of this in more detail when it comes to the soldering video when everything is here. And the Hacko 191 arrived, and boy am I having some fun with that. but I've got a solder station from Maplin Electronics, and there is, it goes by another model number. Why that one? Again, more detail in the big video, but needed some new bits. A friend who also has this station says Hacko bits will work. They buy theirs from China, yada yada, gave me the link to the page, different bit sizes, and all the rest of that jazz. I thought, you know, I want some decent bits on this. Looked up Hacko. There are two official Hacko resellers in the UK. I approached one and said, look, this is the station I've got. I'd like to try and get some genuine Hacko bits. Which ones should I get? Because there's a few different models. And they basically came back with a polite version of Hacko bits will only work on Hacko stations. Okay, fine. So I got some Hacko bits from China. Huh. And that pretty much puts the end from me buying any genuine Hacko stuff. If that's their attitude, or if that's the attitude of the frigging official resellers in this country. Stuff that for a game of soldiers. So, while I was waiting for those to arrive, I basically got in touch with Antex. Because as you know, I've got the few irons. And, this is another story. That I was looking for spare bits for the XS25s on Fleabay. Came up with one seller soldering... what the hell was the name of the seller? They are on here and I'm going to have to go for hidden, but I'll tell you the name, the eBay name, shortly. Soldering and Craft. That's the name. Soldering and Craft on eBay. Looked up and thought, okay, five bits. Two point three mil bits. Something, I just got five bits. Bought those. And then went through the store. And thought, damn, they actually sell packs of three. Two packs of three, same price. So sent a query, and because this was on a Sunday. And lo and behold, the email came back from antex.co.uk. Ha ha! Antex! Soldering and Craft are Antex. Brilliant. So, wrote an email back explaining the sort of situation, what I was doing, that I was a complete amateur. They helped out, sort out the bit mess that I got myself screwed up into. Which is cool. I also asked for some codes for some spare parts. And I screwed that up as well. Aha. I think it was just as well that I did think about spare elements for these irons. Because I put the new tips on them. And both irons went over 500C. According to the 191. Now I've been getting reasonable readings from the 191 from the... from the Maplin solder station. It isn't Maplin, I think it's just rebranded, but so I had some reason to trust it. Not accurate, but when those bits went well over 500, one of them oxidized pretty much almost immediately. I thought, something's wrong here. And it turns out that the elements I ordered were the wrong ones. Little bit of a hint. If you do wind up looking for the elements and you have the part number and you go to the site and you do a search and you wind up with just one grey thing of number with nothing else, you know, you normally get part number and the description of the item, whatever it is, but this just has the number. That's it. It's clickable. Don't do what I did and try and search for it in a general search engine and try and do it that way, because that's how I wound up ordering the wrong elements. Bit of a pain, yeah, but on the site, click that link, follow it, and away you go. So I've got to straighten that out. In the meantime, I tried the Chinese bits, one of the Chinese bits on, which is the fake Hacko bits, on the Maplin iron. Yep, the bits fit, no problem about that, but yeah, you can tell that they're cheap. And I'm glad I've got the cheap clones, because I clearly do not know how to treat the bits properly. I found out why people prefer or why the metal coil is recommended over dragging over a damp sponge. Thermal shock. I was away into this clock project and I just wrecked the bit. It just stopped taking solder and yeah, I mucked it up pretty much. So that's another bit dead. Oops. Now, 10 out of 10 to Antex on this. In fact, 11 out of 10. Once I explained a few things, they also sent some more information about caring for solder tips and a few other things which might explain some of the pitting on a few things and some of the temperature differences as well. Because even though we're using 60-40 solder, the tips are being engineered for silver solder, for lead-free. So they're running at a higher temperature. That's the way they're engineered. Which explained one thing. yeah, there was some paperwork. Oh, it's over there. And it also explained some of the composition of how the tips were made. And the knock-on effects of all this commercial switch to lead-free solder in 2005 onwards and what that's done, which might explain some of Big Clive's pitting issues that he was getting. I did actually send him a note because also, as well as the pitting issue, one of Big Clive's concerns was that he couldn't get the single bits that he wanted from Maplin. They were selling them in blocks of three. Maplin have gone back to selling single bits. So, I've been learning some interesting stuff. Now, the XS25s, it's going to be a while before I've got replacement elements. And I'm not even sure whether the elements are going to work or not. Hint, if you ever need to repair one of these soldering irons, you're going to need another soldering iron because the mains connections to the element, they're soldered on. Brilliant. So, yeah. 10 out of 10, 11 out of 10. To Antex, they've been very patient and explained quite a few bits and pieces that I wouldn't have known, you know. Yeah, 11 out of 10 for customer service from those guys, I tell you. So, I've got the cheap Chinese Hakko clone bits. Which I intend using on the Maplin rebranded soldering iron to practice soldering. Because I'm pretty sure that I'm going to wreck another few more bits before I get all this sorted out. Yeah. Still don't really know a chunk of what I'm doing. Don't know at what point that I actually wrecked the bit. Was I not putting enough solder on? Had I not tinned it correctly in the first place? Was I overusing the sponge and shocking the bit? I don't know. But I dare say that it's going to take the death of another few bits before I actually find out and start getting to grips with a few bits and pieces. How am I going to get to grips with a few bits and pieces? Stay tuned. I'm hoping that my plan is going to work. Yeah. Interestingly enough, I didn't actually get the... Well, a lot of this stuff will come out in more detail. That's the rough story of it, but there's going to be a bit more detail when I do the soldering video properly. But in between there, if I can, will be a video on practicing the soldering and trying to practice the soldering without wrecking another clock. Because that's what it's going to be down to. It's all down to giving things a try and getting used to them. Practice, as a number of people have said. Getting a feel for it. Doing it. And wrecking a few projects in the process. And if you think I'm going to attempt to desolder, I already attempted to desolder the display from the board so I could sort out the bits that I'd screwed up. No dice. I do have some desoldering braid, and I attempted that as well, and again, no dice. And I think that some of it is down to tip temperature. The other thing that I'm probably going to do is rerun some of Big Clive's videos when he was using the Hacker 191 temperature clone and see how he was presenting the bit to the little metal thing. Because, I'm not confident in my readings. I mean, I wasn't expecting anything to be precise or certified, but at least for something to be reasonably accurate. I mean, the way I'm going now, with one of the clone bits, I was reading 490, and then I went to a full adjustment down, which was 50 degrees C, and then I was reading something like in the late 300s or the early 400s, way more. It had dropped more temperature, way more temperature than just the 50 degrees that I'd adjusted the unit by. So, although given what was said, give me a sec and I'll just get this piece of paper. Here we go. Now we've got some time, so I'm going to read you some of this. In 2005, legislation affecting the solder and electronic blah blah help comply. Antex introduced limited range of new lead-free products, as well as removing lead from the manufacturing process of existing products. The new soldering irons and bits introduced at the time featured enhanced iron plating to counteract the erosion properties of many of the new lead-free solders that were coming into the market. So in other words, it reads to me as if the new lead-free solders actually had stronger erosion properties than the 6040. The market's now settled. Historically, all Antex soldering bits were manufactured from copper, then plated with iron to enhance bit life. They were then finished with a cosmetic chrome plating. And there was a spring. If you remember that one of my Antex bits actually had this arrangement, the split and the spring to keep it there. As new higher melting point lead-free solders were introduced in 2005, it was important to raise the tip temperature of the soldering irons. Antex achieved this by changing the fixing method on the lead-free range of bits. The old clip method was replaced by a shim fitted inside the bit. The shim allowed better thermal conductivity between the element and the tip and gave on average a 30 to 40 degrees rise in tip temperature, that's in degrees C. At the same time, all lead-free bits were given an increased level of iron plating to help protect against the aggressive properties of new solders, therefore enhancing bit life. In future, all Antex bits will feature the internal shim and enhanced iron plating for longer life. The external cosmetic plating will also change to an over nickel coat, which contributes to the bit life and is a kinder process to the environment. Changes are already underway, etc, etc. And there's more to this. I'm not able to read the whole thing. And they also sent all this information on tip care and tip failure. And another thing that I didn't know. Another common cause of early tip failure is the use of active fluxes, either as liquids or cored in the solder. They can cause rapid surface oxidization, which forms pinholes in the plating. The tin will then enter into solution with the copper-based material, creating large holes or pits on the tip surface. Be aware that water-soluble fluxes, which are corrosive at high temperatures, can be especially damaging to tips. Many companies use water-soluble fluxes only during wave soldering followed by thorough aqueous cleaning to reduce flux residue on the circuit board. The use of wire solder core with water soluble flux during touch-up and rework operations will still result in very rapid tip failure. One way to minimize the problem is by using a non-corrosive rosin core flux during rework. So much to get my head around. My head is literally spinning with all this, and ugh, there's so much to this. But I think for the moment, I've got to concentrate on my technique, and I've also got to get the temperature issue sorted. I wasn't expecting accurate temperature from the cheapo clone 191. I was just hoping for ballpark figures. And I'm not sure that I trust it yet. Yeah. Not easy. But things are progressing. I was just too embarrassed to film the absolute hatchet job that I made of this clock. And it's going to be interesting to give it a go with the Antex irons once I get the replacement elements. Mm-hmm. Indeed, I'm not sure why they ran to that hot a temperature in the first place. I don't know, because one of the bits just oxidized so quickly. It was just, We'll see what happens. But I'm trying to get all the ducks lined up in a row before I really do the soldering video from soup to nuts. Yeah, it's just, mind-blowing. So I'll see you on the next video, and hopefully on the Friday night I'll get the chance to start taking a look at a practice and the technique that I'm going to use for practicing soldering. Until then, catch you later. Bye for now.